morning. So let's start our discussion on a new topic, which is type conversion. So if you recall from the previous class and the discussion towards end of the previous class, we started looking at how do we now do type checking in presence of implicit type casting. Explicit type casting will be more of an issue at the time of code generation, but implicit has to be done at the time of type checking. So we were looking at some kind of code where we have an expression of this form and type of X and I are different. Now, there are two issues here. Okay. One, that I need to change the representation of. So one, I need to change the representation of I, because finally I want type expression to have some kind of type which is consistent for both these variables and for the expression. And second, I want is that I should be able to find out what is the type expression which is associated with this. Okay. Now it becomes very clear, at least from whatever we know of programming languages, that when I try to mix types of floating point and integer, both will be converted into floating point. So that means basically if internally you look at type, what will happen is something like this. This kind of conversion will implicitly happen. And once this conversion happens, then I know that this type is floating point, this type is floating point, and therefore type expression that is associated with both type expression which is of x plus I becomes floating point. And this is the information I need to carry. Because finally, if I say that I'm going to, say, do an assignment of this form, okay? Before I do an assignment, I should be able to find out what is type of X plus I and what is type of ID and whether this is consistent assignment or not. Remember that we had a rule like this, where we said S is ID being assigned an expression, and there I wrote a rule saying if ID type is E type, then expression is valid, otherwise this is a type error. Remember this? Okay. So with this background, okay, let's look at what kind of code we'll end up generating and what are the things we need to worry about. Okay. So if we take an expression like x plus I, where x is of type real and I is of type integer, then I need to internally change representation of I, making sure that it is compatible with real, and because the operations which are going to be on the machines are really different. And compiler has to convert both the operands to the same type. Okay? So this operand is now being converted to this particular type. And who defines it? Obviously, the language is telling us that what kind of conversions are possible and what kind of conversions are not possible. Okay? So type conversion, normally conversion when I have a situation like this, conversion usually happens from this type to this type. Okay? But there is a small catch here, and that is that if I'm trying to do this conversion, it is possible that in certain conversions, I'm going to lose information. Okay? So for example, if this is of type int and this is of type real or float, okay, then I know that it is going to lead to truncation, which is equivalent to loss of information. Now I don't want that. Okay? So implicit type conversion also puts a rider saying that I will not do a conversion if there is loss of information. So usually it is going to be to the left-hand side, provided there is no loss of information. Okay. Now, is it possible that I still want to typecast a real into integer? But in that case, I will say that compiler will not do it. Let the programmer decide whether they really want to lose information. So you may have functions like round, you may have ceiling, floor, and so on. Right? So those are kind of explicit functions, and where I will not let the compiler do any conversion, but I will let the user do the conversion. Okay? So type checker is used to insert conversion operations like what I have inserted here. So when I say x plus I, what it is converted into is x, and plus then becomes real plus, and I becomes into real. Okay? And type conversion is also called implicit or coercion, if this is going to be done by compiler, like in this case. Okay? And this is only limited to situations where there is no loss of input. Okay, so this point is very important, that compiler does not want to take sort of responsibility for what programmer may have in mind. So compiler is saying, I will only do conversion if it's only a matter of changing the representation and no change of information. If you want to explicitly change certain information, do an explicit type casting, but do not depend upon the compiler for doing that. Okay? So conversions are explicit if programmer has to write something to cause a conversion. So for example, if this conversion has to be done, then we are leaving it to the programmer, and that is going to be now an explicit conversion. Implicit conversion will happen only when it's a matter of change of representation and no loss of information. Is this point clear? This is a general principle which is followed. Okay? So now let's get deeper into the code. So suppose I'm just worried about this kind of expressions. Okay? So if I now have to capture, basically, now I have both integer and real types, and ID type I know will be available in the symbol table. Okay? So for this, I know that E type is int, and for this E type is real, and for this E type is nothing but just saying that look in the table and whatever is the type, get that. Okay. Interesting thing that happens is here. Okay. And for the time being, let's assume that I only have type mixing between integers and reals. Of course, you can expand it to whatever is defined by the language. But assuming that at this point of time, language only permits mixing of integer and real type. And if I know E1 type and E2 type, I want to find out what is the type expression for E. Okay, so how will I do that? What kind of code I will end up writing? So earlier, when I wrote this and we were not worried about type conversion, what is the kind of code I wrote? Do we have a time when you guys can come to the class? I mean, just look at the watch, what is the time now? I mean, this is a 15-minute class of which 10 minutes are gone, which is 20%. I mean, why do you have to come? Is it necessary to come to the class? If you can't come on time, I mean, why do you come to the class at all? You just need to schedule your activities. What activity did you have in the morning? Did you have a class before this? Then why can't you get up 10 minutes earlier, plan to come here 10 minutes earlier? So what kind of code I will now write for this? So earlier, when I just had no type mixing allowed, then what was the code I wrote? So if there was no type conversion allowed, then we said if both are of type integer, then it was int, right? And if both were of type float, then it was float. Okay? But now with implicit type conversion, what will happen is I will permit mixing of types of int and float. And how many combinations are possible? So both can be int, both can be real, first can be int, second can be int. Right? These are the four possibilities I have. So now I'll say that if both are int, okay, then this type is going to be int. Okay? Now I can write a very short notation that assuming that only types which are possible of E1 and E2 are either integer or real, so I just need to write else real. Right? But I'm not going to do that. And what I'll do is, rather than just saying else real, I will now say, let me enumerate all possibilities. And it will become evident why I'm enumerating all possibilities. Okay? So now I'll say that if the first is int and the second is real, then this becomes real. And if first is real and the second is int, I think these colors are not very bright. I'll change it. Sorry about this. This is finding that on display is not coming out very clearly. And then it is real, and if both are real, then this is real. Okay? Now you can see that in these three cases, because outcome is real, I could have just eliminated this and could have put else real, and that would have worked. Right? Okay? Now why I am doing this, why I am enumerating everything here? Any reason for particular reason? Does it give me any additional information? So let's just look at this. Okay? I mean, even if it is not commutative, how does it matter? I'm not even worried about that. I'm scanning always my input from left to right. So at some point of time, I'm going to integrate my code generator with the type check. Okay?
And when I integrate my code generator with the type checking, then at this point I will say that the first operand needs to be converted into a real, and therefore I will insert a small piece of code here saying that convert whatever this variable is into a real number. And here I will have to insert the code. So really what will happen is that no type conversion here but type isn't, no type conversion here but type is real. And in this case, it's although type is real, but this or this will have to be implicitly coerced. And therefore, I will have to insert code for saying that insert this function which says into real, either for the first operand or the second operand. And therefore, I want to enumerate all the four options. Because as I said, at some point of time, this will get expanded and the code generator will become part of it. Otherwise, if I am just doing type checking, then I don't need to do anything else. Then I did not require these enumeration of three other cases. Right? Okay. So this is not giving me any additional information. Now next issue we need to deal with is overloading of functions. Okay. Now what is overloading of functions? So let me go back. Okay. And let me look at this. Okay. You notice here that I started with x plus I, but then when I was doing type checking, I said this plus is a real plus. Right. Now it is possible that if I am just saying I plus j, where both I and j happen to be integers, then my code or type checker will say this is I integer plus j. Okay, so it's the same plus operator. In one case, this is a real plus. In another case, this is integer. Okay. So what I have done is I have overloaded this particular function. And depending upon the context, I am finding out which is the real operator. Remember, on machine, this operator, which is integer addition and real addition, they may map onto different outputs. Right? So I need to, at time of type checking, I need to find out what real operator is. Okay? But actually, situation is far worse than this. Okay? So there are some operators which, by definition, by mathematical definitions, they are overloaded. Okay? So many times you notice all arithmetic operators are going to be overloaded. For example, take multiplication. Okay? I can multiply two integers, I can multiply a combination of integers and floating point numbers, I can multiply two floating point numbers, and opcodes are going to be different, so my type checker needs to tell me. Okay? So those are by nature. Okay? But what happens when I overload a function? That is permissible in certain languages. Okay? So let's take a situation where I say that I am not only overloading of operators is possible, but overloading of functions is possible. And then languages like Ada, which will permit you to overload functions. You can take a standard function. So I can take a standard function like plus and overload it with something else. I can define a function plus and have a different operator for this, different operation for this, in addition to the built-in operation. And the question that will now come is that if I now write an expression like this, what is the definition of the function I associate with this? And how do I figure that out? How will I figure that out? Prototype of the
function means the function is explicitly declared by the programmer. It has to be different from the prototype that's already defined.
So prototype is the same, only return values are different. So I can have a function like this. I can have, let's say I can overload. So let's take this function. Okay. Now, normal prototype of this function is, let's say this is a normal prototype. Okay. But I can also have, let's say, I can overload this and say that it maps onto complex. Okay. Now, if I give two integers, should I use this function or this function? So, left hand side, I don't know, but let's say it depends on the context. The left-hand side is actually restricting the context. Okay. So what we want to do here is, we want to see that if I have overloaded functions, how do I resolve them? What is the kind of method I have, which is going to help me resolving these overloaded functions? Okay. So suppose I have overloaded this function. So let's now look at a situation that I have overloaded a function in, let's say, Ada, which is function star. And these are the two prototypes which are available. I'll add more prototypes for this. Okay. And now I want to find out that which is the right function to apply here. So what it is doing is that suppose I take
two integers here, it is going to return a complex number to me of the form a plus ib, or this is just going to give me a multiplication of ab. Okay. Now, in this case, clearly outcome is integer. In this case, here the outcome is a complex number. Okay. Now, I need to look at the context. Okay. So, suppose I say that I have, so let's look at a situation like this. That I have, let's say, 2 and 3, and I apply this function here in multiplication. Okay. Question I want to ask is, what will be the type of 2 star 3? Okay. Now, just by looking at this sub-expression, I will not be able to find out what is the type of 2 star 3. So, suppose now I say that I put it in a context which where I say that 2 star 3 multiplied by, let's say, 5, and 5 also happens to be integer. Then I clearly know that what will be the definition of this particular function, which prototype will apply? This one, right? Because you know that there is no operation which is defined on integer, complex and integer. That is invalid. Okay? But suppose I have something like this. Where that happens to be? A complex number. Then which prototype will I apply? Then obviously, because again, there is no operation which is defined on integer and complex, and for this to be valid, this must be complex. Okay. So, I may have to have add another prototype. So, let's go through this example first, and then see how do we resolve these issues. Okay. So, overloaded symbols, they have different meanings depending upon the context. And the context is the one. So, it's not just the left-hand side, but even the right-hand side context. So, therefore, I use a general term that it is the context which determines. Okay? And if addition is overloaded, this is used for integer, real, complex matrices. In fact, yeah, this is another interesting thing. So there are languages where you may have data types like matrices. If you take language like API, okay? Where data type would be integer, floating point number, a vector, a matrix. Okay? And if I want to do multiplication of two matrices, all I need to say is A multiplied by B. I don't have to write a nested loop. If I want to take two vectors and I want to do addition of two vectors, I don't have to write a loop saying do an element by element addition. All I need to do is say add vector A and B. And the semantics of this operator is defined right there. Okay? So ADAP now permits overloading, which is used for arrays, functions, call type conversion, and so on. Okay? So if you look at brackets here, so brackets are overloaded. They can be used in many of these contexts. But overloading is resolved when you find that there is a unique mean. Okay. Now what you have to understand here is, and this last point is very important, that to begin with, when I just look at this, okay, I do not know what is the function which is being applied here. But then I start looking at the context. Okay. And when I start looking at context, I try to resolve it. Okay. And I keep on resolving till I find that there is a unique meaning which is associated with this. Now if at any point of time, I come to a conclusion that there is no unique meaning associated, I say this is an error, because such a program should not be written. Because if it cannot be interpreted, then we have a problem, right? So if we can't interpret it, obviously compiler cannot. But if I find a unique meaning, then I associate that meaning with it, and that is the function prototype which is going to get. Okay? So let's look at a situation where we say that in ADA, the standard interpretation of star is multiplication, but it can be overloaded by having multiple types, multiple arguments and return types. So I can now have this, and this is the kind of syntax. It says that function star takes two integers and returns a complex, and can also take two complex numbers and return a complex number too. So basically, this is saying that I can do integer multiplication. I can take two integers and return a complex number, which is of this form, a plus ib. Or I can take two complex numbers and do multiplication and return a complex number. Okay? Now, if that happens, okay, then the possible type expressions or the prototypes for star are these. I can take integer cross integers, which gives me integer. I can take integer cross integer, which gives me complex. And I take complex cross complex, which again gives me complex. Okay? And now, if I, after this overloading, suppose I say 2, 3, and 5, these are integers, and z is a complex variable, then what will happen? 3 star 5 is either integer or complex depending upon the context. Right? I had to determine the context there.
So if I say my context is like saying 2 star, 3 star, 5, okay, then what is the context here? Context is that I am taking an integer here, and therefore, since I don't have a prototype, it will say that integer cross integer multiplied by complex, such a prototype is just not there. Then I say that this is only going to be an integer, but if I have something like this, then I know that this has to be complex, but because again, complex and integer multiplication are not allowed. At least I don't have a function for it. Right? Now, issue that comes is, how do I do that in terms of writing the code? So, let me go back and remind you what is the code we had for function resolution, and then we'll try to modify that. So, I wrote something of this form where I said E1, E2. Remember, this is the kind of syntax we had. Okay, and what is the code I wrote for this, for type checking? I wanted to find out E type. And what was E type here? You remember the code for this? So we said that if E1 type is equal to a mapping from S to T, and E2 type is S, then T else type F. This is what we have, right? Now what may happen here is that when I start applying, see, so I don't distinguish between function and operator. I mean, it's just a matter of syntax. Basically, semantically, what is happening is exactly the same. Okay. Now what may happen here is that when I say E type, if I say that I am taking the first function, which is 3 star 5, okay, then what could be E type? What will be E type here? Will it be this type error, or it will be T? And if it is T, then what will be value of E? So I just look at only this. So let's just take 2 star 3 here, or just take 3 star 5. Okay, I'm applying the function here. So what will be type of 3 star 5? Just go by this rule. So what are the changes I make here in this week? Do I need to make any change, or I'll just use it in the same manner?
So there in that code, where even dot type is equal to s dot t, we can add multiple types. If even suppose that if the function supports multiple types, then we can add that also.
Good.
Then based on its arguments, we can decide what to.
So only change I need to make here is, rather than saying T, it will be a set. So to begin with, all I am saying is that E1 type, remember that I know E2 type, right? E2 type in both cases is int. Okay? But E1 type will say that int cross int matches to int, and int cross int also maps onto complex. So all I need to say here is this T. T instead of a single value will be now a set. That's the only change that will happen. Really nothing else will change, right? So this is the kind of things we'll do. And now, once we start doing this, okay, at some point of time, I need to have a unique value. So remember that this will occur now in certain context, okay? So when I started by saying that I'll have this 3 star 5, at some point of time, this 3 star 5, when this reduction happens to E, this will occur in certain context, okay? And that context is going to be 2 star 3 star 5. Okay. So again, I will do this and say that when this resolution happens, again, I will have a set of types. But at some point of time, I will know the complete context. And at that point of time, I need to say that only one type is possible and rest of the types will have to be discarded. So I discard all those types. So one way to look at this is that if I'm building my expression tree, and in expression tree, if I have an expression tree like this, so let's say I have an expression tree of this form, then I start finding out types. So if I say, what is type of 3? This is int, and
This is int, and what is the type of this star? This could either be, value here could either be either integer or complex. And then I'll say, this is int, okay? I know that C is not defined here, so this can only be int. So I can come down and discard this, and I have resolved. Okay? So actually, it's a two-pass process, where I first say that I start bottom-up and start building all the types and find out the sets here, rather than a unique value, which was possible when I did not have overloading. And then, once I have reached the top, at that point of time, I must know that it must have a unique type. And if it does not have a unique type, that's a type error. Okay? But if it has a unique type, then I use that information and start traversing down once again and say that certain types will be discarded. And if at every node, I need to find a unique type, because that's the only way I can generate code. That's the only way I can call a function. Right? So let's look at an example of this. Okay? So type resolution is that try all possible types for each overloaded function. In some cases, it may be possible, but absolutely a brute force method. We are not interested in those kind of situations. So keep track of all possible types. Okay? And this is what I'm doing. Okay? I'll keep track of, using these kind of rules, all possible types, and then discard all invalid possible. Okay? So when I start traversing down, I will start discarding this kind of information. And then at the end, check if there is a single unique type for every operator I have. Okay? If it's a single unique type, I'm done. If it is not, then I say this is type error. Okay, so how do I write code for this? So overloading can be resolved in two passes. So first pass is the bottom up. Compute set of all possible types for each expression, and top down is when I start narrowing down the set of possible types based on what could be used in an expression. And that comes from the context. Right? Make sense? Okay. So this is precisely what we do, that now my code will look something like this. That when I say E prime goes to E, I'll say that, so let me first write the full code, okay, and then show you. So basically what is happening here is that if I say 3 and 5, okay, these are integers, and this is star, okay, and if I have a type expression like this, which says E goes to E star E, okay, then I know that types of star are I cross I going to I cross I going to C, and C cross C going to C. These are the three overloaded types, but since these are two I's, then I know that third type is not possible, but these two types are possible, and my outcome is going to be I and C. Okay? And then I'll traverse down, once I have resolved what is the unique type of this, I'll traverse down and discard one of those types. So suppose I come down and say, in this context, in the context this E occurs, C is not possible, then I'll say this is I, and therefore this I cross I going to C will be discarded. Okay? And only the first type will be used. Okay? So basically what happens here is that if I look at these types, I look up ID, and now I say what is E type here. This is a set T, where we say that there exists some S in E2 types and S to T in E1 types. Okay? So I will not say this is just T, but it could have multiple values. Okay? So rather than having a single value of T, what you end up with is a set.
So if each operator has to have a unique type, then how do we resolve something like 2 into 3 into 5 into 10?
Don't worry about what compiler does. You tell me, suppose you were to write such an expression, okay, how will you resolve it? How will you interpret it?
You have to
mathematically.
Rightmost, the first unique representation, then we have to.
So, first I will make an expression tree for this. An expression tree says that I am going to, it has certain rules, Bodmas rule, right? That I have start reading it from left to right and start evaluating it from left to right. Okay? So, suppose I were to write two star. 3 star, 5 star, Z, right? This is what you are saying?
2 star 3 in brackets and 2 star 3 into 5 in brackets.
This? Yes. Right? Okay. Let's make an expression tree for this. How will expression tree for this look? This is an expression tree? Yes. Right? Now, if this is I and this is I, then you know that it can be either I or C. Right? What about 5? 5 is I. Okay.
Now, what are the types of this? IOC. Right? Okay. So, if this is, because if I take I star I, see, C and I combination will not be permitted. But I know that if this is I and this is I can still get I and C here. Okay? And this is C. Right? So far, clear? Okay. Now what about type of this? C. Okay, but what is C? What C means? That I can take now two inputs in complex and multiply it. Now, as soon as you say this is, because I and C are not permissible, only C and C are permissible, you will discard this. Then I start coming down. Does it resolve?
Is it possible to do this in a whatever pass?
No, wait a minute. I already said that we have multiple passes. Don't worry about now passing technique. Although it can be done still in a single pass, okay? But doesn't matter if you have to do multiple passes. Here, you have a bottom-up pass and you have a top-down pass. So I'm not even trying to do it in single pass. Although I mean with a lot of jugglery and moving about the rules, it is possible to do it in one pass. Okay? But let's, at that point of time, let's not worry about whether I'm doing it in one pass. Okay? Let's say that even if I have to have multiple passes, I can do it. And I show you that. Yeah.
So in 2 cross 2 into 3 into 5, it's still not clear what will be the type of this.
That's the type error. Okay. So look at it this way. That I say that if this is C, okay, then is if I say I and I, okay, then isn't it clear that what I'm trying to get here is that I am taking here an integer value. Okay? Because remember that C and I combination is not permitted. I don't have such a prototype. Okay? So this C anyway is not allowed. Okay? Then I know that what I am doing here is I am starting with integer, giving an integer, taking another integer, now giving a complex, and then taking two complex and doing a multiplication of this.
In the second one.
Which one?
The second one.
Second kahan se yaar, ye? This
so
one?
This, after this whole expression is passed, we are still not clear what will be the type.
We are not. So that's the bottom up phase, right? So what happens here is, so look at it this way, that I'll keep going up, okay, till I reach the last operator at the root. And the root I say that, now do I know the unique type? If I don't, that's a type error. But if I do, then I use that information to come down, and for each node, I try to determine the unique type. If I'm able to do that, then I'm successful. If I'm not able to determine that, I flag a type error. So it is possible that you can overload a function in a manner that I'll never be able to resolve it. Okay? And then I'll have to give a type error because I don't know which function to use. And in any case, if I can use more than one function, I'm stuck. So compiler is only implementing it. Look at it this way, that if I cannot resolve it, there's no way compiler can resolve it. Clear? Any more questions on this? Okay. So this is what we do here, okay, that we keep on resolving these types. So first thing that happens is rather than having a single value, I will now have a set of values. Okay. And how do I narrow down this set of values? Okay. That this requires, now programming language says that a complete expression must have a unique type. Okay. Anything else is not permitted, anything else is a type error. Okay. So what we do is, given a unique type from the context, we narrow down the type of choices for each of the expressions which are below in the tree. Okay? And if this process does not result in a unique type for each sub-expression, then we declare a type error. Okay? So how do I write the rules now? Narrowing down the types. So basically, let me again, let's have full code, okay, and see what happens here. Okay? So what we have is, when I say EID, EID says, so look at two kind of rules. Actually, I could have color-coded it, but it's okay. So when I say that E goes to ID, that time I just do a lookup. So the assumption is that every variable has been declared as a type. So if I say E goes to num, then I know that E type is integer. If E goes to num.num, then E type is real, and if E goes to ID, then I just look at my symbol bit. Okay? And when I parse this, when I parse using this particular rule, which says that I have a function, then I say that E types is, so this is the rule we saw, that E types is nothing but a set of types. Okay? So forget about this part. Don't even read these four lines for the time. This is what I do. Okay? Now, once I have constructed this, then I say that, now I say what is E prime type. E prime type here, when this is the star tool which says E prime goes to E, E prime types just takes the value of E types, which is going to be a set. Now, this is the start symbol, and now I check whether this type is unique or not, whether the cardinality of the set is 1 or not. If it is not 1, then I have a problem. But if it is 1, then we say that what is E unique, that's a new variable I define. And we say if E prime types is T, then this is T, otherwise type F. So it must have only one type when I reach the start symbol. By then, it should have been resolved. Okay? Now, if it gets resolved, if it is not type error, then we say now let's come down. And that is where we start looking at last four lines. Okay? And we say that here, now I'm trying to resolve type. So here I now define a new variable which says, what is my E unique? Now, E unique must be having a single member. Cannot have a set anymore. Okay? Because I've seen here, because if E unique is not a single member, then I give a type F. Okay? So what do I do now? Now I say, let me find out types of arguments. Okay? So now I say that if S belongs to E to type, and S going to T belongs to even type, then if E to type is S, then this is S, otherwise type error. And if even type is S, then this is S going to T, otherwise this is a type error. Okay? So basically, I mean, just understand this code. What I'm doing here is that first I have reached here. In fact, I mean, you pointed out a good example, which you can just parse using this, that when I reach here, I check what is the type of this particular function. Okay? This is unique, so I'm happy there. It's not a type error. But then I start coming down saying, can I now narrow down, earlier when I said I had I comma C here, can I narrow down it by saying that only IC is not a valid combination, only C and C is a valid combination, and therefore this type is discarded. So this immediately becomes unique, and I keep recursively coming down till I am able to narrow down type of each of the star symbols. Okay. And actually if you now see implementation of this, okay, you'll again find I am using the same jugglery, and which is that I am resolving something which is an inherited attribute and something which is a synthesized attribute. And the combination of this basically helps me in doing it in one pass. Okay, but there is no guarantee that I will be able to do it in a single pass. There are languages where I can get into multiple problems. But basically, okay, the trick remains the same. That have a two pass, have multiple passes, two passes. Keep on building types till you reach the root. And at root, if you find you do not have a unique type, flag a type error. But if you find at root you have a unique type, then keep coming down and keep resolving types of each of the descendant nodes. And wherever you find that you are not able to resolve, flag a type error. Otherwise, you are done. Clear? Questions? Anything? So as I said, right in the beginning, we are not going to go for type resolution in functional languages or languages where types are not declared. We are always assuming that I'll always be able to find type of a variable by looking at my symbol table. Okay? Now there are languages where such a declaration does not exist. Value of or type of an identifier could be determined only from the value it is assigned. So I can take a variable, I mean take something like basic. Okay? I can take a variable. Start by assigning an integer value to this, and subsequently I start a floating point value to this. And then subsequently I assign a totally different type to this. Okay. The functional languages operate in this manner. And then a lot of work actually goes on in type resolution. But that is, as I said, is a separate course. In fact, you need to know a lot of lambda calculus and type resolution and type associations and so on. Just to do that, and that becomes a very major issue for both functional languages, as well as when you go into processing of languages like natural languages and so on. But we keep out of that domain, and we just have languages where you say everything is, all variables are a priori declared, the types are known. And therefore, this actually plays a major role, okay, which says that this lookup will always be able to give me the new type. It's going to die. Okay, so this is where I want to close discussion on type checking and move on to code generation. Unless you have any question about what we have done in type checking. It's clear? Can we move on to the next topic? Okay. So let's move on to then the code generation. So what we want to do is now, we want to start generating code, and if you recall once again, what we did in our compiler structure, we had a front end. So let me just remind you of the structure we had. We had a front end, we had a back end, and within back end I said that we are going to have at least two phases, one which will give me the intermediate code and other which will give me finally the machine code. Okay? And of course we had an optional optimization phase which we will introduce only towards the end after doing code generation, because this part is optional. At least we must know this box and this box to complete our compiler, and if time permits we can see that how do we improve code, what are the techniques which are available to us for improving the quality. Okay? So now what we want to do is we are here and we want to talk about this box. Okay? And this box is saying that I have done type checking on the program. Now I know that this program is correct with respect to the specifications of the programming language. And once I have resolved that this is now correct, I know meaning of each and every symbol, I have resolved all my operators. Okay? I want to now convert that into some kind of code which is closer to the machine. So I'm not straight away generating machine code, but I'm saying I will do it in two steps, and I want to move into two steps. One where I have some kind of notation, which is not exactly the machine instruction, it's not the complete syntax, but is much closer to the machine resources. And in the final phase, when I do machine code generation, at that point of time, I will convert this representation into a complete syntax of the machine, okay, which will look exactly like what an assembly language program does. Okay? So, abstraction at source level, once again, so this is, again, I have captured from the introduction, and this foil gives you the functional specifications of what we are trying to do, that the abstraction we started with were identifier, operator, expression, and so on, and at target level, what I am having are, again, memory locations, register stack, opcodes, addressing modes, and so on, okay? And code generation is going to be a mapping from here to here, okay? And we want to take all the source level abstractions, and we want to map them onto the target. This is what my aim is, okay? And in this, okay, I'm going to use first the front intermediate code generation. So front end translates source program into an intermediate representation. So normally what happens is, logically we may say that I have a front end and I have this, but actually what happens is that you can implementation wise fit all of this. Okay? I'm leaving the optimization out for the time being. You can fit all of this actually into some kind of same physical code. Okay? So you'll see that when I talk about intermediate code generation, I still talk about syntax dynamic translation. That as I'm parsing, at the same time, I'll be able to not only do type checking, but I'll be able to generate code straight away. Okay? So backend generates target code. Target is now the target machine from the intermediate representation. So my backend really, when I talk about my backend, this generates code starting from the intermediate representation. So you have to distinguish between the logical activities and the way I implement the compiler. Okay? So logically I may have many activities, but I am able to put them together into a single physical phase. Okay? So what are the benefits of this model? Obviously retargeting is possible, and machine independent code optimization is also possible, because remember that this phase is giving me some kind of intermediate representation which is independent of the machine but is closer to machine. So I'm not doing optimization at the machine level here. And this is how my logical structure looks. I have a front end, I have intermediate code generator, and I have a machine code generator. Okay? And what we have done so far is this part, and this is where we are moving now. Okay? And therefore, first thing I must remember is that if I'm talking about this box, what is my input and what is my output? So what is my input here? Logically, I'm not worried about how implementation is done at this point of time. What is my input to the intermediate code generator? an abstract syntax tree which has been completely resolved, where I know meaning of each of the operands and where I know the exact meaning of each of the operands. Okay. And what is my output here? Output is going to be some intermediate representation, which we don't know at this point of time. Okay. So remember that we started talking about, right in the beginning, we started talking about some kind of universal intermediate representation, which could then be targeted onto any machine. Okay. So let's now start looking at what is the kind of intermediate representation I may be talking about. Okay. So intermediate representation design becomes a very important issue for us, because this is really going to be the interface. And it's not just interface between a machine code generator, but it could be an interface to many machine code generators, because I want to target different machines there. Okay. And therefore, this design has to be done very carefully. Okay. Now, first thing that happens is, unfortunately, we have been talking about science and principles and so on. Okay. And first thing that happens is we say that there's not much science involved. And what we're talking about is wizardry or artistry, saying that how do I design an intermediate representation? It's almost like saying, how do you write a good program? Do you have an algorithm for writing a good program? We perhaps can't even define what a good program is. You may have certain guidelines, but you cannot say that, give me a program and I'll be able to look at this program, or I'll have a tool which will look at this program and say this is a good program and this is a bad program. Right? Both the programs may achieve the same functionality, but then, I mean, you look at a program and you say, well, this program looks very good, very easy to understand, fast to execute, and so on. Okay? And you look at some programs and then you say, I don't want to touch such programs, I don't want to look at them again. Okay? Similarly, when you say IR design basically comes from a lot of experience of the compiler writer. So if you have been in a compiler project for 20 years, when you have this sort of now inbuilt skill where you say, oh, this is a good IR, because this is going to serve all kinds of machines I'm going to encounter, this is going to help me in doing code generation, this is going to help me in doing optimization and so on. Okay? And I can design a very bad IR, and you'll suddenly find that you keep going back and forth till you are able to achieve all the functionality. Okay? So first thing is that is an art really, and each compiler uses multiple IRs. So where are the multiple IRs? If I look at this, okay, first IR, what was the first IR we encountered? Stream of tokens, right? And what was the next IR we encountered? Abstract syntax tree, which was not resolved. We were also talking about parse tree, but as I said, parse tree is more of a notation, which is really compiler does not worry about. Okay? It's a logical notation. And then we have another IR, which was a resolved syntax tree. Okay? So resolved syntax tree is the one where all the operators have been resolved, and then we look at other IRs. Okay? Now, IR could be at multiple levels. Okay? So we have one notation which is used this clearly is what we know as HIR, or high level intermediate representation, where I say that I want to preserve all the loop structures and all the array information. Okay? Now, at this point of time, it may not be clear. So let's look at what are the other IRs that we may have. Okay? So another IR we may have is what we know as medium level intermediate representation, or MIR, you will find in short, which has a range of features which is basically close to the set of languages we have, okay? But still remains independent of the language and is also good for code generation for multiple machines. Okay? And this is appropriate for a large number of optimizations. But what happens is, then why I am talking about even this kind of IR? There are certain optimizations you may want to do, and therefore it becomes really an art, where we say that I'm designing an IR keeping overall compiler structure in mind, keeping overall functionality I want to achieve in compiler. So if you design an IR where a lot of information is lost. So let's take an example. Okay? Suppose I say that I have a loop in the program. Now, how do you translate normally loops? You will have a sequence of test steps. Okay? So suppose I have something like this. For I, let's say 1, 2, n, and I plus plus, and then I have this set of statements. Now, when I'm doing this translation, normally what will happen is that I'm going to convert this into a sequence of test integers. So I'll say that maybe I is stored in a variable, which could be a register variable. And then every time this loop has to be executed, I'll first check whether this is still within the bounds. And then I'll execute it, I'll come back, I'll implement it, and I'll keep on doing it. Okay?
Now, many times, suppose I want to do optimization right here. I want to recognize that there is something a loop. Because remember that I can convert this into a sequence of tests and jumps, but not all sequences of tests and jumps can be converted back into loops. So as I keep on moving from abstraction, which is at source level, up to target level, every time I do translation, I'm losing some information. So when I'm losing information, there's no point saying I'll go back and start reconstructing that information, because I've already put in effort and I have lost information, which I may not be able to recover. So many times when I want to do optimization at this level, and suppose here I have now an array which is of this form. So this is a very simple form where I say A is assigned B, and each for each element of B is being assigned to A. What is going to happen here is that once I convert this, what is going to be the conversion here? When I convert this into a language which is close to machine language, what is the kind of conversion you can think of?
Load and store.
Load and store is a general technique. I mean, where you load something from memory and then store it back. No. If you look at conversion that will happen is, that I'll say, take the base address of B, I know the base address of A, and I'll take the first element, then I will increment I, and if it takes 4 bytes to store an element, then I'll say that whatever is the base address, I add 4 to that, and keep on doing it for all the elements. Okay? But suppose I want to do certain optimizations and analysis on I. Okay? Now take, for example, something like I plus 3. Okay? And I want to do this analysis on these index values. Then I lost that information out. Okay? So what I'll try to do therefore is, I'll try to preserve HIR. And once I have done this, okay, then I'll be able to do this resolution or this optimization. Okay? So depending upon the kind of things I want to do, I either want to keep HIR there, or I want to go to MIR, depending upon the kind of optimization I'm doing. Okay? So this is, we'll stop our discussion today.